All right, here we go. First question is this. What does the Bible say about husbands? And this is kind of interesting. There's actually not like tons packed in there about husbands. There's enough, okay? There's some good stuff, but there's not just tons. In reality, a lot of the stuff that's true of husbands is just true of Christians. If I kind of, that's kind of the idea is, Paul or Peter or Jesus doesn't feel like they have to give a whole lot of instruction specifically to husbands, because if you're acting like a good Christian, if you're acting like Jesus, then the husband thing will somewhat fall into place. But there are a few things that the Bible says about Christians, and so I want to address a few of those real quick, starting with, let's see if this works. Genesis. We're big time. We're big time here. Starting with Genesis 2:24. Okay, this is the first. Okay, two chapters in the Bible. First instruction we get about husbands, and I mentioned this passage last week. This is actually one that is quoted, I think, six different times throughout the Bible. The first place you see it is Genesis 2:24. And it says this, that a man shall leave his father and mother, and he will be united to his wife, and they will become one flesh. That there is a union, a unity that takes place in their life. And that means this, that for a husband, his first priority, his first allegiance is God. And then his second is his wife. That he not rejects his family, but it is always from here on out, wife over parents, wife over siblings, wife over everything else. Okay, that becomes his first priority in his life, and his primary responsibility outside of God is his wife. It also means this. Jesus will quote this passage, and he'll say, a man will leave his father and mother, be united to his wife, and they will become one. And then he says this, and so let man, what God has joined together, let man not separate. Okay? In other words, what happens when a man leaves his father and mother, when he becomes one with his wife, there is a oneness that takes place. Okay? And when he stands up there, and we're going to talk about this in a couple weeks, when you stand up there on your wedding day and you say, I do, you are not just making a covenant with your wife, you are making a covenant with God. That's your head. So Jesus says, God joins those two together, okay? And so what happens is, on that day that you choose to be through with this thing, and I'm stepping out, you're not just stepping out on your commitment, your covenant to your wife, you're breaking a covenant you made with God on your wedding day. That's a big thing. And Jesus, like I said, uses this specific verse to talk about that. So the first thing we see is a man will become one with his wife. This is the passage we've been studying, Ephesians 5. The husband is the head of his wife, and he is to love his wife sacrificially as Christ loved the church. He's the head of the wife as Christ is the head of the church. He is to love his wife as Christ loved the church. And we don't need to get too much into that because we talked a little bit about it. But let me say this. Headship means, okay, get this. Headship means care, not control. Okay? Headship means responsibility, not rule. Okay? That's actually a statement from John Stott. Headship means care, not control, rule, not responsibility. So my role as the head of my wife, it does not mean that I boss Amy around. It does not mean that she does whatever I want. It means my job is to care for her. It means that my job is to look out for her. It means this, that Amy will one day stand before God, and I believe that she will be, fortunately, she'll have Jesus to answer in her place for everything, okay? And so his grace, his blood covers everything. But on some level, she will be responsible for the actions she took to grow into Jesus' likeness. She'll be responsible to God for what has gone on in her life and how much she has pursued him and how much she has obeyed him. I, one day, I believe, will stand before God, and I will be responsible for myself and my own growth. And I also believe, to some degree, I will be responsible for Amy's. That's what being the head means, is that I am to help her in her growth, okay? I love her sacrificially, okay? And when we talk about love, what we mean is that you do what is best for that person. And what we believe is best for a person is that they become more like Jesus, that they become more who they were designed to be. When this gets abused, what happens is a woman's womanhood gets taken away from her, gets crushed. When this is done rightly, a woman becomes more of who she is supposed to be. Okay? And so that means this, that a man who sacrifices and works 60 hours a week at a really good job to make sure he can provide his wife with the biggest house and the nicest car has failed in his job to love her sacrificially. Because loving her sacrificially doesn't mean getting her all the nicest things. And listen, it's good, guys, little hint, little clue, okay? It's good to get your wife nice things sometimes. But that's not what it means to love her as Christ loved the church. Loving her as Christ loved the church is helping her to be more and more like Jesus, okay? Not necessarily through, you know, classes. You're not sitting down and lecturing her, but through the way you love her sacrificially. Ephesians 5 says that. 1 Corinthians 7 says this, okay? A husband's body, from the day he gets married, a husband's body no longer belongs to himself alone, but it actually also belongs to his wife, and vice versa, okay? This is actually in the context of sex, is what Paul is talking about. And he says that as a husband, when you get married, that you are no longer just your own. Your body is no longer just your own, but you belong to your wife and she belongs to you. And in the context, he actually says, so do not deprive each other, okay, of basically sex, is what he's talking about. So, guys, this will be a really good verse to remember later on when you're married. So, hang on to that one. But I would put in there, I think Paul would rightfully put in there, and this is my own word, but I think Paul would put right alongside that, you do not deprive each other of sex, and you do not demand sex. Those two D words together probably work. Okay? So both of those things go together because that person is not just their own, they're yours, and you are not just your own. You are theirs, okay? Those two things go together. He says this later on in 1 Corinthians 7, that a married man's, a husband's interest will be divided because he will seek to please God and his wife, okay? Paul talked about this, and he claims, the way he talked about this, it seems like he believes this to be normal and right and unfortunate a little bit. Like he even says, I wish more of you could be like me and just be single. He says an unmarried man can set his interest. He can set it all about pleasing God. And they are undivided. And he's all about seeking him and obeying him. But a married man, his interests are now divided. And he needs to be able to please God and please his wife. Okay? What that means, I would say basically this. There are benefits to getting married. There are growth benefits that you can only experience when you're married. Okay? There are some ways that you will only be able to grow, or best be able to grow, I guess I should say, when you're married. Like there are a few things that are going to teach you how selfish you are and how selfless you need to be in getting married. Okay? That does it. Okay? But there are also some types of growth, some growth lessons that will best be learned while you're single. Okay, there's some, the amount of time you can devote to seeking after God and His Word, the amount of risks you can take, the amount of things you can go do on a whim, those things are cut down. Okay, so I say that to say this, not to say, so wait as long as you can till you get married. Okay, I say that to say, take full advantage of the 2, 3, 5 years you have left. Because once you're married, you're never back here again, and you're going to lose some specific opportunities you have. Like, when you're married, if an opportunity comes up to just go on some missions trip the next week, you can't just go do that when you have a wife and kids. Like, if you're married and there's a need that comes up and somebody needs a lot of money, or there's a specific ministry that needs a lot of money, you can't just go cut a check without talking with your wife first. It's hers, too. And that goes vice versa for women. Okay, that's the same for you guys. It goes, and so there are things you're going to lose. Let me say this. If you struggle, if you don't want to listen to and obey God and follow hard after Him, even when it's difficult now, it's not going to get easier when you're married. So you need to do what you can now to learn to seek after Him and follow Him and take risks following Him, being faithful to Him now, so that carries over well when you're married. This is another passage, Colossians 3, which is actually a parallel passage to Ephesians 5, has a lot of the same statements, but he says this, he adds this, a husband should love his wife, and he should not be harsh with her. Paul, most likely when he was writing this, in a patriarchal society, and we talked about this last week, that women were viewed as second-class citizens, and so most likely he's talking about basically being overbearing on your wife, being over-demanding, being aggressive, and maybe even some level of physical aggression, and that's most likely what he's dealing with. But I would say this, that there are two different kinds of being harsh, okay? There's that first that we all acknowledge is wrong and we all want to try and stay away from. And then there's this second kind that I think is a lot more common today and a lot more common even in the church. And that is where husbands take these little tiny shots at their wife all day long with their words.
Yeah.
My dad was just talking to me about a guy in the church, and he was recently going out to have dinner with him. And he was talking to me about him, and he said, you know, this guy is a good guy. I know that he would do anything for me if I asked him to. But he said, I'll tell you this, if his wife was my daughter, I would want to kill him because of all the little comments he makes that tear her down constantly. Like, and he just thinks he's joking most of the time. And he mostly just thinks he's teasing. But those things, I believe, and I didn't even know who he's talking about. Okay, I was friends with his kids, and I believe those things for the last 20, 25 years, whether he knows it or not, has been chipping away at his wife's self-worth and value. Like I said, maybe not even intentionally. I'll tell you this, in the time I've been able to watch my dad growing up, I have never heard my dad belittle my mom's intelligence, belittle my mom's appearance, or belittle my mom's abilities. And I would say, man, that is a commitment that you should make to God and to your wife, that you are not going to do those things, even in a somewhat joking manner, okay? That doesn't mean you can't tease them, okay? It doesn't mean you can't joke around with them, but too many guys like to make little goofy comments kind of at their wife's expense about how she always burns the cooking, or about how she can't ever figure this out, and she's always doing this, and she's always screwing this up, and they think they're joking around, but those things tear at God's daughter, okay? Those things chip away, I think, at your marriage, and so I would make that comment, or I would make that commitment, you were never going to belittle, intentionally belittle, okay, her appearance, her intelligence, her abilities, okay, those things. Now, girls, let me tell you this. At some point in your life, your husband is going to belittle your intelligence, your appearance, and your abilities, okay? It's not that he's mean, it's
and
just that
vice versa.
Yeah, that's true, that's true. But, that is true.
You're not the same. Sorry, go ahead.
But I would say it's probably not because he's mean, it's just because he's stupid, okay? So like we all are, okay? And there are times, and I really want to make sure I never do that with Amy, but there are times that it happens, and I don't mean to. And girls, it's like, it's okay, you need to be able to point that out. Again, like the other day, my wife was just kind of, she was talking, and she slipped up and she was talking about how she did all this housework all day, but instead she said she did homework all day, okay? And so, like, I was able to tease her a little bit about that because that's just a slip of the tongue, okay? We're joking around, but that has nothing to do with her intelligence. That has nothing to do with her abilities or anything like that, okay? So there is that kind of line, and it'll be a little bit of a learning process as to what is too far and what's not too far. But that's something that I think is important, that we honor our wives. They're a gift to us. Okay, that leads us to this next one. There's this really interesting verse where Peter says to some of his followers, his listeners, a husband ought to be considerate with his wife and honor her. And he says if he doesn't, then his prayers will be hindered. Okay? His prayers will be hindered. Okay? The idea, this is what Mark Driscoll gets at. You cannot abuse your wife. You cannot abuse God's daughter and then go ask God to help you out in life. Like, you can't do that. There's going to be one day my daughter will be married probably someday, and her husband, okay, or her boyfriend or whatever, cannot mistreat her and then expect to be in my favor. And that's the idea that I think First Peter is getting at, on the way that a husband is to be considerate with his wife. He's to honor her. The ESV, which is a little bit more of a literal translation, says he is to live with her in an understanding way. Okay? Live with her. Like, that's something that is incredibly important to girls, is to know that they are understood by you. To know that they are understood. I was just reading this story, I think it's today actually, about a guy who, he's talking about how his wife was under a lot of stress, and she was trying to get the house all clean because they were having guests over, and they had this big event that I think she was planning, and there were all these things going on, and she was trying to get it, running all these errands, and then all of a sudden she had squeezed in a hair appointment that day, and her hairdresser calls and says, "I'm sorry, things are crazy, so I'm not going to be able to have you, and I got to cancel this." And that was somewhat kind of the last straw, and she just kind of started losing a little bit. Now guys would normally say, "So get your hair done tomorrow." Okay? that's our kind of, so what's the big deal? This guy had learned, okay, in his I don't know how many years, to say, like, "I'm sorry. Like, I understand that. It's like, that's hard. I'm really sorry about that, babe." And she later said, like, after she went away for a little bit and rinsed my hands and came back, and she said, "I needed to hear that. Like, I didn't need you to fix it. I didn't need you to do my hair. I didn't need you to get me into, like, I needed to know that you understood in a weird way that this was difficult for me, that this was hard for me. And I don't always get my wife, but I'm trying my best to understand her." And guys, let's not act like everything we do, like, makes sense or is understandable either, okay? So there are definitely some weird, you know, when we check our fantasy football team more than our email or our homework or anything else, weird things like that that girls don't understand, okay? It goes both ways, but it's important for husbands that they would be understanding with their wife, that they would honor them. I think that's what I got for that.